morning, everybody. Welcome to Sunday School. We're still studying from the Gospel of Luke. Just a reminder, it's hard to know often how to make contact with the most number of people, and so we repeat some things from this service to the next, but let's continue to remember Janice and Ronald. These are dear friends of the Stevensons. And Janice is in the hospital and just having great difficulty breathing. So continue to pray for them. There are others we're praying for and praying about. I hope that you have a prayer list that mentions all of our members by name. If you may have a better memory than I do, and I wouldn't question that at all. But I do not have a good enough memory where even if I was trying very hard. What I do often, most of you sit in nearly the same place. Ronnie's in the completely wrong place today, but I wouldn't sit next to Terry either. So, there you go. Dangerous. That's the way I pray a lot of times, and the way I think of, have I contacted everybody, or is there anybody that has fallen through the cracks of my mind? I have lots of cracks in my mind. So I think of where you sit. Dotson's right over here. Bailey right there. Ward's right there. The other Ward right there. But that's not... I think I've missed some people like that. So I really rely more particularly on a list. And then I'm concerned... there's probably someone who has seen my list many times, and you say, well, he left Joe off. He always leaves Joe off. He never has had Joe on the list, but they never tell me. Shame on you. Someone would come up to me after the service and say, preacher, when you said this, I thought of that. And I said, well, you should have stood up and said something. You hollered it out, or don't let me overlook something. Or we get out in the parking lot and say, preacher, we forgot to do birthdays today. And, you can't hit people at church. You're just not really supposed to. If you knew that, you should have said, we hadn't done the birthdays yet. Sometimes I think people just about rather see you fail than actually get everything done. Well, that's enough of that. That's not preaching. That's a meddling. Let's look at the Gospel of Luke. We're in part 11, and we're going along, and as the Sunday School Quarterly kind of jumps back and forth. Well, I transferred these over, and I just clicked on that one. It says it will not open that PowerPoint. So let's... All right. Well, I know where I'm going, so I'm just going to go and open a Bible, and we're going to go to Luke's Gospel, Chapter 5. Evidently, I did not test that. I just copied it over. And I'm not going to take the time. Let's pick up in chapter 5, and starting with verse 17. I want to look at something, and then there's a kind of a take on this that I have had for a long time. It's not unique with me. It's not something writer of Ecclesiastes is not completely correct when he says there's nothing new under the sun. But there are many things that when I think I've had a brilliant idea or a notion, I find that others have had it before me. It's not uncommon. if I were in the business of writing music or poetry, or if I wrote more creative fiction, I would be concerned about maybe things that I'd heard or read before winding up to be claimed as my own, not intentionally, but I believe that happens many times, and probably many judges see cases where people are accused of theft of creative material. But this is something that, and let's look at this, starting with verse 17, it says, "It came to pass on a certain day, as he was teaching, that there were Pharisees and doctors of the law sitting by." Now, it was a long time, a number of years in my Christian journey. I became a Christian when I was 14, and I didn't realize when I first began studying the Bible, it talked a lot about the lawyers or the experts in the law. They were very prominent characters in the story of Jesus because these people were brought forward by his opposition, feeling that obviously Jesus was raised in Nazareth. He didn't go to the very best synagogues. He was people. Remember when Nathanael was told that the Messiah had been found? He was from Nazareth, and Nathanael said, "Can any good thing come out of Nazareth?" Well, we have lots of prejudices like that. Now, it doesn't matter how much we change or improve, and believe me, in my lifetime here living in Alabama, I have seen so many wonderful changes for the better from the way that they were. I know a lot of people say, "Well, I just wish we could go back to the way things used to be." And I'm thinking, are you insane? Don't you remember the way things used to be? And people have very, very selective memories of the, I believe it was Dolly Parton who wrote and recorded the song, that one of the phrases in the song was, "The good old days when times were bad." She says, "No amount of money could buy from me the memories that I have of then. No amount of money could pay me to go back and live through them again." Well, we've had lots of improvements. Things, if you don't believe it, let me tell you, I'm not one of those apocalyptic preachers. I don't believe we have to go to hell to get to heaven. I don't think everything in the world has to. Most people's eschatological theology is that everything has to go completely to crumbs before Jesus can come back. Well, I don't believe that's what the Bible teaches. It's not that I don't believe the Bible. I just believe the Bible differently than they do. I believe there's a possibility that we can have victory in Jesus, that the Great Commission can prevail, that God's will can be done. I have great optimism and great hope. And I when I see, yes, times are difficult, things are hard, and there are always going to be tremendous problems and great sadnesses and disasters and catastrophes. But right now, overall, when you're talking about probably some of the 20 major criteria in the world, in the 21st century, things are better for humanity than they have ever been. We're fighting fewer wars. The crime rate is lower. There's less murder. And the thing about it is that we have so much news, and it runs in cycles 24 hours a day, it overwhelms us. And we think, we've heard the same story about world hunger 1,000 times. And people have been telling us since the 1960s that the world's going to become so populated with people that we're going to fall off the world. Well, the planet right now is in a negative population growth. Fewer and fewer people are having babies. People are waiting till they're getting 30 and 35 even to marry. And then they start come along around 40 years of age and say, "I wonder if we should have children." And so, no, you could take everybody that's in the world living today and put them in Jacksonville, Florida, and they could all probably stand socially distant from each other. No, we're not having a population explosion. And yes, the ice is melting over here, but guess what it's doing over here? It's freezing at record rates. So many of these things that we look at, the reason they were trying to catch Jesus is because everything that they thought about Jesus was wrong. Everything that they assumed about him, and you'd think, you know, once you get, if the door screen slaps you in the face 2 or 3 times, you'd kind of figure it out after a while. I think it's over in Matthew chapter 13 where it says the Sadducees came and had some questions for Jesus, and then the Pharisees, and then the lawyers. And, you know, they like it was hitting him with a barrage. And the very last verse of that chapter, I believe it's Matthew 13. This is not part of my notes of preparation. It says, after that, they didn't ask him any more questions. And I'm like, okay. Getting smarter. Are we learning now? Everything they assumed or thought they knew about Jesus was wrong. And right here, when we're talking about the lawyers came, I know I was watching a clip yesterday about someone who was talking about having taken the bar. And I've studied for the legal bar. You have to pass the bar to become a lawyer in the United States legal system. That's not what this is. When you're talking about a lawyer in the New Testament and lawyers confronting Jesus, they were experts in the law of Moses. They were Bible scholars. They were people who knew every jot and every tittle of the Bible. And so these people are attacking Jesus. Well, that's what it's mentioned right here. Behold, men brought in a man in a bed that had been taken with palsy, and they sought means to bring him in and to lay him before him. When they couldn't find a way, well, we read this last Sunday, of course, that they brought this man into Jesus and lowered him down through the pallet. And it mentions here, I think it's one other line that I wanted to pick up as well. In verse 12, let's go back just a notch. Came to pass, there was a certain, in a certain city, he says, behold, a man full of leprosy. Now, see, Luke is a doctor, so he says it was a certain city. Matthew would have said it was Bethsaida. What? A certain city? You know, a doctor, that's the way they think. We have our doctor. He's really zoomed in on certain other things. Whoop, and, you know, whee, it's gone. And so Luke says it was in a certain city. Matthew says, tell him what city it was. But he starts telling, no, I won't tell him about the leprosy. And because he's a doctor, you know, and he says things like, Jesus touched him. Matthew says, he said, I will, be thou clean, and immediately he was cleansed. Luke says, no, he touched him. He reached down and put, look right here. If you will, he says, you can make me clean. Jesus put forth his hand and touched him, saying, I will, be thou clean. Luke's a doctor, and he says, I ain't gone. That's real important. It doesn't really matter what city it happened in, but the fact that he touched him. And, so that's why God used Matthew and he used Luke to write these things. Now, in verse 14, he said, he charged him to tell no man, but go and show thyself to the priest and offer for the cleansing, according to as Moses commanded, for a testimony unto them. But so much the more went there a fame abroad of him, and great multitudes came together to hear and to be healed of him of their infirmities. Let me tell you something. All this is leading up to this, and maybe this will work. I do have a video that I want to show you. Let me just minimize that. Back in probably around 1972 or early in 73, a new pastor came to our church. And during that time, our church was building a pastorium. And it was just right at that time where it was just right at the cusp where it was still a good idea to have a house that belonged to the church where the preacher could live. I'm not going to say wholesale. It's pretty much a terrible idea. You wind up with lots of old retirement age preachers and their wives, and guess what? They're homeless. They don't have any place to live. They have lived in some nice homes, and they've been taken care of. I remember the first house that we lived in, and then I found out that the church paid for the pastor's electricity and his water and his phone. They just paid for that. And then on the very first business, you know, this was new to me. I don't even know if my pastor, I have no idea. I do know that he had that he lived in an apartment that later became a chiropractor's office. But he and his wife and little girl lived in an apartment, and then the house was ready, and they were the first couple to live in that home right there at the church, right in the parking lot. And I don't know if they paid for his house insurance or if they paid for his electricity or phone or anything. But I remember at the third or fourth business meeting at the first church where I pastored, someone said, "Well, it looks like the preacher's light bill's a little high this month." And I'm thinking, what? And they debated that. I was sitting right there, and they were talking about what could be done, maybe to bring my light bill down, or maybe they asked me some questions. Was I leaving the windows up? Did I turn the lights off? And so the next day, I went to the treasurer's house, and I said, "Church will not be paying for my electricity anymore. I know I don't make much money, but how many lights I have on is none of their business." I was not in the spirit. And with that little bitty paltry amount, and they were paying me as much as they could. You know, I'm just venting now. They were paying me probably as much as they could pay me, a whole lot more than I was worth. But from that time on, I lived in their house, but they didn't pay for anything, any of my utilities. That has nothing to do with what I was about to say. But I feel cleansed.
Good. As long as you feel better.
I do feel better.
Good.
I felt good then. I thought I was going to burn to a cinder till I could get that taken care of, and I did. But they'd been doing it like that for years, and the pastors had always been turning their lights off because they didn't want that to be a topic of discussion for the whole church at the business meeting. I just didn't know it. I was 20 years old. But I learned quickly. Now, you might learn quick, but that's wrong. It's quickly. And over, our pastor invited some of us to come over to his house after church. He probably had left his daughter on the front pew asleep. They did that about half the time. Trisha was just a little girl, and she'd lay down in the front pew and go to sleep. We'd turn out all the lights at the church and go over to his house, or sometimes we'd go for pizza. I don't remember us ever going for pizza and then someone saying, "Where's Trisha?" But I do know we'd get to his house every once in a while, and somebody'd say, "Where's Trisha?" "She's probably on the front pew, still asleep." And we'd go over and get her. It was not negligence. It was just, we were all... Sunday night services at our church were just, they bordered on the Pentecostal. We just had fun. It was just, we had some formality, and we observed a lot of tradition on Sunday morning. It seemed like Sunday night was just wearing short sleeve shirt and let's have a good time. So I liked Sunday night service. But we went over to his house, and he had a record player out. You do know what a record player is. Never mind. Google it. Record player. And he had a set of vinyl LP records. And there was about six or eight records. And they all had their own little paper sleeve. And then they fit in this big... And what is this? He says, "I want you to hear this." He says, "This is news. It's really been taking the country by storm, and it's just kind of like now getting to Alabama." He said, "I spent a load of money and I ordered these because I've been listening to it." And he put on a record. And I really liked rock music. I mean, I liked Stones, I started on the Beatles. But, you know, I like soft stuff. I really enjoyed the Monkees and the Archies. Just about any kind of music, and I don't know if you call the Monkees rock music or what. They were contemporary music. But as the Beatles kind of came along, they got a little edgier and things like that. The Rolling Stones were always harsh and hard, but not heavy metal kind of like that. Anyway, and he started playing this, and this was orchestra-level rock and roll music. I mean, amped-up guitars, drums, bass guitar. It was rock and roll stuff. It's like you would go to a concert, but it was also strings and horns. It was wind and everything, a full orchestra. And it was Jesus Christ Superstar. And he just began to play them. And you just kind of think, you know, you go over to your pastor and family, and they're making pizza or whatever, sandwiches, and some of the teenagers are there. You kind of think, you know, no, let's do something fun. No, this absorbed me. He actually came with a little manual, a little book with it that had the lyrics in it. And I'm really not sure. I may have been the only one that really got, but I was just sitting there and I played them. I don't know. They probably had to ask me to leave later on. But later on, I learned everything that I could. And over the years, Jesus Christ Superstar, a rock musical that presented the Passion Week of Jesus, has been presented on stage, and there have been a number of movie presentations done of this by different actors. Because, and a lot of it was just wrong. For instance, Jesus Christ Superstar ended, the musical ended with the death of Jesus. It didn't include the resurrection at all. So I said, okay, that's pretty obvious. But a lot of the things in it it was all based on the Bible and on the scriptures and on the story of Jesus. But the music was great. And some of it was just very thought-provoking. Now, here is a video. And I haven't tested this. I told Danny we would run into all kinds of snags. This is a clip from a modern movie production from Jesus Christ Superstar. And it's dealing with this idea of Jesus healing people. And then Luke says, and suddenly, you know, Jesus told this leper, don't tell anybody. Don't tell anybody. And then the next verse says, hey, then everybody heard about it. So he probably said, and then just went out and says, and you know, everybody says, who is that? That's the leper. No, the leper has leprosy. Said, no. He went home to his family, and he scared them to death when he went in. Hey, it's me. Wait, well, you're not supposed to be here. And you know, it was leprosy. It's kind of like me and Terry coming to church after having the coronavirus. Saying, you know, you're not supposed to be here. No, that was weeks ago. We're done. We're like, we have superpower now. If you give us a big kiss on the mouth, it'll probably give you complete immunity. But if Terry starts coughing, she needs to move off over here by herself somewhere, put her mask on and put a sack over her head. We still have some of the symptoms. I still get piercing headaches. How does it look? Looks bad to me. But this is a clip called Heal Yourselves. I hope this works. Let's see. Says, see my skin, I'm a mass of blood. Thank you. visibly and audibly. More and more sick people. More of multitudes. I need this. I want this. I'm hurting here. If that conveys to you the way that it even does here, but that song sounds almost identical to the one I heard in 1972 as it came off that record, and it showed me something that I believe is very possibly true that was a part of the Jesus story. It says a leper came and Jesus touched him, and then all of a sudden the next verse says there were multitudes. And they had their bandages on and their wraps, and they lived in a society where crippled people and people with mental disabilities and physical ailments were pretty much ostracized. They were outcasts socially. I remember when I was a little boy, our grandmother, my mother's mother, came to live with us. And our grandmother had her own plates and silverware and glasses, tableware, the instruments that she ate with. And then she had a little electric skillet, a steamer, and she had found one and she had evidently been very creative, where all of her eating utensils and plates or saucers or coffee cup or tea glass, everything would fit in there. And then she would put some water in there, and then, I don't know how much, but a tablespoons or so of Clorox bleach. And she would cover that, and she would heat it till the steam was coming out all around that fryer or cooker. And then she would do that for a certain, she did this for every meal. Did that for every meal. And then she would unplug it and let it cool off with the lid on. Then she would take it out and she would wash the dishes in the sink and put them in her own little special place or container for the next meal. You know why she did that? And she did it. I watched her do that for years, and I asked her why. Little kids, they'll ask, you know, what's wrong with you, little mama? Why are you doing that? Do you know why she was doing that? She had had tuberculosis. She had had tuberculosis. Now, if you get out on Highway 31 and you go down the highway and you get to Flint, and you look up on the hill up there on the left, you see that big water tower. I always thought it looked like a golf ball, that giant golf ball someone was about to tee off on. That was, in my childhood, it was what it had been built to be. It was, I called it, or my heard my parents call it, the TB sanatorium. And my grandmother lived there for a long time. She was diagnosed as having TB, tuberculosis. Now, I don't know if you've ever even heard of tuberculosis, if you're an old person like me, you have. If you're a young person, if I spoke with my two granddaughters, they probably have no idea what TB is or what it stands for. And, you know, a lot of young people these days have no idea what tuberculosis is until they go into some vocation where they have to be tested. They still do that. You still have to have a tuberculosis test if you're going to work in the cafeteria at school or be a nurse or probably be a teacher, I guess. I don't know. But if you're going to work with the public, you still have to have a TB test. And I imagine a lot of young men and women say, what's TB? No, they probably are already in their schooling. Maybe I'm being less than optimistic there. Today, when we have a disease or a virus, we quarantine everybody. Back in the olden days, they only quarantined the sick people. That seems to make more sense. But in a sense, I can see the people in Jesus' day were pushed out of town. You can't live with us anymore. Lepers, most especially. And if anyone comes within any distance of you, you have to shout out and tell them that you're unclean. Hey, I'm a leper. Hey, don't get close. You have to warn them. The fact that Jesus reached out and touched one of them is just mind-blowing. And so these people heard that there was a man who was healing people. When I heard this song, I said, that's you know, Matthew says, and then multitude. Jesus healed this man, said, don't tell anybody. And then it says multitudes of the sick and the halt and the lame. And even they were tearing the roof tiles off to lower people down in front of him. There's another story where a woman, there's one of the women in this depiction says, look at me, I'm a mass of blood. There was a woman who had an issue of blood. And it says that she had spent all of her money on physicians. Luke doesn't mention this story. An issue of blood, that means her usual menstrual cycle never stop, and for years, she had been, this is something that drained her life, her strength, her energy. It was literally her life's blood. And that's terrible enough. But do you know there's a whole section in the Mosaic Law for women that during the time of their menstrual period, they're unclean. Did you know that? You can't go to the synagogue, can't go to the temple, can't offer sacrifices. Anything or anybody who touches you or that you touch becomes unclean, like sinful. This is a part of the law. There's so much of the law that we can't comprehend, but God was trying to make an impression about sin and how he sees it. This woman was dejected and discouraged and broken. And Jesus, it says that Jesus was in a throng of people. And the disciples were surrounding him and doing everything. Remember, Sunday before last we looked at Jesus had to step off into a boat just so he could get a little bit of distance, just so he could, you know, look, you know, everybody back up. He was being mobbed and mauled, and it's very understandable. And Jesus was very compassionate. But when he was going to teach, he said, you know, I just need a little, let me stand in the boat, let me sit in the boat back here. And so at least he could talk to them on the shore, and they still were just right sitting and standing in the water. But this woman thought, this woman with the issue of blood said, if I can just touch the hem of his garment, I believe it would make me well. If I could just reach out and touch one of the tassels on his rabbinical robe. And with all of this going on, she believed that she could do this. Now the blind men had said, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. The lepers came and fell at Jesus' feet. But this woman said, John, I don't want anybody to even know that this is the kind of thing that you would nobody knew about. Even people in her family, probably the women in her family, knew that she had this problem, her husband perhaps. But this also would prevent her from having children if she was of childbearing age. We don't know how old she was. She pressed forward and climbed and clawed. And, you know, Zacchaeus had to climb up in a tree so that he could just get a glimpse. And so I've put all this together and I say, what did Jesus feel like? He never screamed, heal yourselves, it's too little of me. And yet, this is saying something about how it must have been. This woman touched Jesus, and it says as soon as she touched the hem of his garment, she knew immediately that she was healed. You know, you don't remember what Jesus said? He said, who touched me? Who touched me? And Simon Peter says, huh? What? What do you mean? What do you mean, who touched you? He said, you're being swamped, you're being mobbed, you're being mauled. And you say, who touched you? Jesus said this, I felt virtue leave my body. Have you ever noticed that? Jesus said, I felt someone touched me and something in me that God gave me that's a part of who I am went out from me. It left me. You know, when we plug something into a wall outlet, we don't think of how many watts it's being used or how many volts. But what if every time Jesus touched a leper, a part of who he was left him? It was something that he felt. It was something that went away. I have no idea what that might feel like. But what if every time Jesus touched a crippled person or a leper or a blind person or cast a demon out, what if virtue, what if every time something, he gave up something, he was sacrificing, there was a part of who he was, a part of his very divine essence that was, he was. It wasn't just a magic touch. It was, here is me. Everything you receive from Christ is not just some magical power. It's him. He's giving you not a miraculous event. What if all the good that Christ does for you and me is literally him giving himself to us and for us? This was important for me. This is important. That when Jesus was on the cross, he was emptying himself. He was pouring himself out. Not just pouring it on the ground. He was pouring it into anyone who would receive it. And sometimes the Bible just said, and Jesus was weary. He was tired. And the day had been long. There is in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, what Bible scholars teach or describe as the long day. from every, it lists many things, things he taught, places he went, things he did, miracles he performed. And from every indication, from Matthew's standpoint, Mark and Luke, all of that seemed to have happened. And at the end of the day, someone came up to the crowd and said, John the Baptist has been executed. The long day. And I'm thinking, the long day of Jesus. Well, it's important for me. I think it's important for you to let these things from the scriptures be a part of what we meditate upon. And I'm grateful to my pastor many years ago of saying, someone has seen this in an unusual way, and maybe it's something that we've overlooked. And when I saw it, I believed that to be the case. Over the years, I have taught or had classes or Bible study times where I invited people to come to listen to Jesus Christ Superstar. Some people just don't understand good music when they hear it, for one thing. There's a song that Judas sings. Actually, it is the title song. It is the theme song. Judas is singing. Judas is the main character in Jesus Christ Superstar. He has more lines. He sings more than anybody else. And he says, did you mean to die like that? Was that a mistake? Or did you want your messy death to be a record breaker? Don't get me wrong. He says, I only want to know. Well, be that as it may, it was at that time that I began to say, God is going to speak to me during my life in a lot of unusual ways. If God talks through an ass to someone, then I need to listen to everything that's going on around me, and I have. I hope you are too. So many people might say, well, that's not a very faithful rendition of the gospel. So I say, yeah, but it's somebody is looking at the story of Jesus in a way that is not traditional or not usual, not ordinary. And here is a place where I think they might have come close to hitting the nail on the head. How tired and weary and exasperated and empty Jesus must have felt dealing with all the things that are wrong with us. All right, God bless you all. Thank you so much for tuning in. In just a little while, we'll be back here at 11 o'clock, and we'll see if my PowerPoints work for that session. God bless you all. Thank you for your prayers for us. Continue to pray for each other.